June 1817, a group of approximately 300 men from the villages of Pentrich and South Wingfield marched on Nottingham in what they believed was a larger, coordinated uprising to overthrow the government and replace it with one that would better serve the needs of the labouring classes. Since the end of the Napoleonic Wars in 1815, Britain had experienced an economic slump, which hit the poor hardest. This had not been helped by the government's sanctioned enclosure of common land. The combination laws, which since 1800 had made it illegal for workers to form unions to protect their interests, and the corn laws, whose duties on foreign grain were good for farmers, but pushed up the price of bread. The stocking makers and quarrymen who were marching from Pentrich, led by Jeremiah Brandreth and Thomas Bacon, had been encouraged to rebel by a government spy known as Oliver. However, they discovered a detachment of the soldiers from the 15th Regiment of Light Dragoons waiting for them. The rebels then attempted to flee the scene, but about 40 men were seized. Brandreth was on the run for a month, Bacon nearly two. As the Lord Lieutenant of Nottingham, the Duke of Newcastle, wrote to Lord Sidmouth, the plot had been hatching for some time, which we knew, and were prepared accordingly. We thought it was much more desirable to let the matter come to a crisis than to endeavour to crush it before the designs were openly disclosed. I am very glad we adopted this mode, as we have now not only become acquainted with what the bad people will do, but have ascertained that the country people are not of their way of thinking. Here at the National Archives, we have a document which details the case against Brandreth, also known as the Nottingham Captain, Bacon, George Wakeman, William Turner, and 42 others who were to be tried for high treason by a special commission. On the 9th of June, the men were accused of being arrayed and armed in a warlike manner, that is to say with swords, pistols, clubs, bludgeons and other weapons, being then and there unlawfully, maliciously and traitorously assembled and gathered together against our said Lord the King, and attempting and endeavouring by force and arms to subvert and destroy the government and constitution of this realm. Bacon allegedly admitted that for the past 30 years he'd been trying to effect a revolution, and having previously been a Luddite leader in Pentrich. According to the authorities, Bacon and the others seized on the discontent of the manufacturing and labouring poor, arising from the want of employment and the price of provisions, in making their plans for rebellion. But was the rising really Brandreth and Bacon's plan? The government anticipated that the spy Oliver would be central to the defendant's case. It may be expected that the counsel for the prisoners will endeavour to create a prejudice in the minds of the court and jury, and prevail upon them to believe that Mr. Oliver, the acknowledged agent of the government, has been the principal provider of the conspiracy with which they were charged, and that they have been the dupes of his villainy and artifice. As Professor Valance argues, Oliver had certainly helped bring the rising forward, but he had not conjured the insurrectionary mood out of thin air. In the end, the defence contended that the marchers were simply men after bread, beer and cash, not revolution. This was not enough to save their leaders, though, who were hanged and beheaded on the 17th of November 1817. 11 more men were sentenced to transportation for life, and 3 to imprisonment for 14 years. The fate of the men of Pentrich had an unanticipated consequence, though. The involvement of Oliver and the willingness of the authorities to let the conspiracy mature to the point of rebellion turned Pentrich, as Professor Valance concludes, from a dangerous revolt into a shameful government-orchestrated sham.